It is currently 1:09.
Copenhagen, Denmark. So I'm just walking down the street here. I came across like a Mexican-themed restaurant. This is the Border Burgers and Burgers. Burgers versus burritos. I don't particularly care to have any food right now because I've already eaten. But I saw something familiar, and I'm gonna draw your attention to it. Check it out. So what are we about to do?
We're about to...
Where are you?
Oh, shoot.
Randy doesn't even know where she is. What day is it?
I'll just say 10:09.
Yes. Okay. All right, so film me walking back then.
Okay.
All right. So we arrived here at the Academy Museum where they have the exhibit on black cinema. So that's what we're here to do. So let's walk down the hall. This is the fourth floor. Black cinema, y'all. How many black celebrities of old and new can you name? There's a wall in here with pictures of celebrities from as early as maybe the 1920s to maybe the 1970s. The question is, how many can you name? How many do you know? I feel personally that it's a shame that I wasn't able to identify and name all of these stars, because that's our history, that's our heritage, you know? And we're not taught, you know, these people, we're not taught their lives. That's such a shame. And I think they would give us a greater sense of identity, of contribution, rather than having us swept under the rug. But that's how it is, you know. All right, so over here, this is the door. We're gonna go in here. We can't record. Once we go in there, so we're gonna shut it down right now. But this is our trip to the Academy Museum, the Black Cinema exhibit on 10/9. It's my birthday. I'm with my lovely wife Randy, who didn't know what day it was. She knew what day it was.
I couldn't think of the name.
She couldn't think of what.
We've been to so many museums. I couldn't think of the correct. It doesn't matter. It's your birthday.
Okay, so Randy's here with me. So let's go. says here, race films between 1915 and 1948, more than 150 independent companies produced and distributed black cast movies or race films. It says also that while many films by these production companies are thought to be lost, surviving posters offer a glimpse into this tremendously creative world. Very sad that our history has been lost. These are the movie posters here for a number of these so-called race films. I wonder how much has changed. We still today have what could be deemed race films. Black Panther. That's a pretty much predominantly all black cast, production, crew, and all that kind of stuff. The blood of Jesus. Well, they said that these movies were lost, or only their posters, the movie posters, have survived. Exactly. Or just not cared for properly. We don't have the time, the space, the money to sufficiently, adequately store these, so let's just get rid of them. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar fights Bruce Lee.
I've never.
It's filming now. Picture of Judy Garland walking somewhere along this sidewalk. You can see the Academy Museum. The Academy Museum is back here. At that time, it was the May Company or Mayco, and Judy Garland was walking right here. I don't know if Johnny's was here at the time, but it's here now. I think Johnny's was built around the 60s. There's just so much history around here, it's ridiculous. That's what it is. So. That was the year the black cinema, I think the oldest black cinema archive, the oldest black cinema archive dates back to 1898. On that video they captured a kiss, an on-screen kiss. And so, in observance of that, in observance of the cinematic history, you know, we shared a kiss on screen as well. So, several times today. So.
Yes.
It's recording now. All right. 10-9. That's my day. 10-9. I left about 5 copies of my book right here at Mercato, probably over a year ago. And a couple of them sold, but I still have them on the shelf. Maybe if you come by, you can pick up a copy. But anyway, anyhow, it's 10-9. It's my birthday, October 9th. We went to the Academy Museum just up the street. And now we're in Little Ethiopia having some buna, some coffee. Let me try to run down how many Ethiopian phrases I remember. Gonjo. Gonjo means pretty or beautiful.
Aww.
All right, let's see what else. I think it's Nikerta. Were you gonna say that? Nikerta. Nikerta is excuse me.
Let's go to the other one.
I think Randy is trying to say Milkam Kant.
Oh, yeah.
Milkam Kant. I think Milkam Kant means have a nice day. Let's see. Hello would be salam.
Salamish.
Salamnish for greeting a woman. And then thank you is Amisegin alo. Now, I also learned that to say hello is also tadias. Tadias? Tadias.
Tadias?
Tadias.
Oh.
Yeah. I think so. I may have, you know, butchered these phrases. I hope I didn't, but those are the phrases that I can think of. Yeah, yeah. Oh, what about ishi? Ishi means okay.
Ishi?
Ishi. Ishi. Okay, ishi. Okay, so that's about it. The Aki, the owner, is busy at the moment, so she cannot correct me if I'm mistaken. So if you're watching this, don't trust what I say, because I could have made a mistake. But we are here at Little Ethiopia enjoying some buna. Yeah. This is where Issa Rae filmed her very first episode of Insecure.
She came back on other episodes.
Randy says she came back on other episodes. Yep. I didn't watch all of the season four. I didn't watch every episode. But this is a very cool space because we have pictures of Snoop Dogg, Queen Latifah, Stevie Wonder, Andre 3000, P. Diddy, Marcus Samuelson, Issa Rae, Bono. Bono of U2 fame. You know U2, you know Bono. Who else? All of these stars came right here to eat. That's fabulous history. That's really cool. Oh yeah, and can't forget about Nipsey Hussle. Nipsey probably sat right here. He had an interview and Nipsey was right here, sitting right here. Yep. This is how I'm celebrating my birthday. Right here in Little Ethiopia, in my favorite place in Los Angeles, with my favorite person in Los Angeles.
And we had Kenyan food.
Yes, and we also ate some Kenyan food today over at Flavors from Afar. So, it's been a great day. Remember Chuck Henry, Good Day in L.A.?
Yes.
No, this is Larry Wiggs, Great Day in L.A. How did I handle the loneliness of being alone? How did I handle myself?
Not having family or support.
What was my mental state? Let's see. I'm grateful to have my mother and my father. And for so many years, I never became seriously depressed because I didn't have family. I've been so blessed. 43 years old and I have my mother, my father. I've had my my grandmothers and my grandfather for much of this time. Of course, I lost my grandfather recently, but all of these years, having these people in my life has been sturdy. Very solidified, very, very a strong foundation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just because I had them in my life didn't mean that made my life any easier.
Right.
Didn't mean that I was it didn't mean that I had more guidance, okay? Because my mom and dad told me go to college and get a degree and, you know, and then live your life. And I found myself failing left and right. I've been fired from jobs all around this city, Los Angeles. So through all of this time, I didn't feel sad, depressed, lonely. I felt frustrated. I felt frustrated and angry more so than anything. And I think that when I spoke with other black males, then I had a mirror. I had someone to talk to share my thoughts and bounce ideas off of. And then, you know, I had this one colleague, Mark Savory, who was a member of the Nation of Islam at one time. He was a teacher in Korea, and he was an educator. He educated me, you know. He was very much helping me uplift myself. Like, look, brother, you know, don't look at life through the lens of, you know, these other people. You know, learn more about yourself and know your role. So that gave me perspective, and I was very much interested in history and learning about black scholars, because they were offering me a perspective that was wholly uplifting, that I needed, that I didn't get from any other source. So these things helped fill me up and helped me navigate the terrain. And so even when I joined Brothers and Sisters of South Korea, I certainly felt that I could navigate, you know, life alone in Korea on my own, because I could handle my job and I could handle my finances pretty well on my own. But then there were experiences that were wholly black, and that only another black person could understand. And so when I joined that group and I had other people who could mirror my experience and tell me what I was experiencing and seeing, then I didn't feel as alone anymore. So, you know, when I travel the world today, I travel, you know, with my ancestors. I travel with the knowledge that I'm not experiencing this alone. When I read about the life of Frederick Douglass, you know, a year or 2 years ago, I mean, Frederick walked this path and had many obstacles to overcome, and his life and his journey have been learning about his life has bolstered my confidence and ability to navigate this terrain. I don't take people for, you know, what they say. I know things based upon my what I've learned of history, and you know, Nipsey said, who would you want to define yourself, someone else or you? And I take that to heart, because when I live my life, I have to define these circumstances and situations, and I can't let someone else tell me about the world. I have to know it for myself. And so that's what it's been about. Sadness, depression.
Just going like, when you're behind doors by yourself, like, there's been times when you are not in a relationship. You may have friends, but just you just being, you know, just the solo, like, black person in your home by yourself. I'm like, yeah, you know you had, like, your family, but they were, like, far away. It didn't make you feel some kind of way, like,
I think I met people who, even though I was alone, those people saw me, and they saw my gifts, and they saw what sacrifices I made to, in many cases, to benefit them. I remember they commented, they said, thank you, Larry, for your sacrifice. And I was thinking to myself, but I'm just working here. You guys are paying me to do my job. But they said, no, you've made a sacrifice to be in our country, to live the way that we live. And I thought about it. I said, yeah, you're right. It is a big sacrifice.
And dealing with different cultures and, like, trying to adapt to that.
Yeah.
And that's a lot. And that just
But the thing about it is, all of those experiences have made me stronger. And that's what people told me. When they said, Larry, you travel the world alone? He said, if you travel alone, that's going to make you stronger.
Right.
And when I heard that message and I thought about it, I said, you're right. I'm going to know for myself what my limits are, where I can go, and what, you know, what my experiences are. So that built me up. So I had some really, you know, positive people in my life, and those people were warm, giving, and I never felt alone.
Oh, what? Yeah. Well, sometimes, because you send me texts saying like, there's been moments when you felt like alone, like you wish that you were like, you had somebody with you, like while traveling at times. But I mean, but it wasn't like, I get just in that quick moment. Like when I said talk to you like years ago, and then like recently, like before you moved out here, like you used to say that, like you used to tell me.
There's a level of of intimacy, you know, with another person that I often missed out on, because I was in a relationship in Korea. I did have a girlfriend for a number of years, and that helped mm-hmm. me, you know, forget the loneliness. Mm-hmm. But then there was also I would see other foreigners, and I would see that it seemed to be much easier for them to get girlfriends.
Oh, because
it was a white thing. You know, these Asian women would latch on to these white men. Now, yeah, I felt angry. I remember very early in my years in Korea, the first year, I didn't get the girl that was the cutest to me, and I was wondering. There were many, many cute little Korean girls that I wanted, but things didn't happen for me. And I don't know. It's just been a learning experience, because even the women that I wanted, you know, I had a relationship with one woman that I thought I wanted, but things didn't. They fizzled, and it was like, it was like you have to choose the person that you're going to share your life with carefully. So, you know, this desire and what you want, you have to be very careful, you know, what you bring, you know, and bring into your life. So, yeah, I think that, there's often been some very lonely times. But, you know, the loneliness is what led me to 109.
Like a sense of comfort.
Yes, it's been a sense of comfort for me, because I'd be on the train looking out the window all by myself. Mm-hmm. All by myself, looking out the window and just being like, wow, where am I going to be next year? What's the next adventure? What job am I going to do? Yada, yada, yada. Mm-hmm. And then people were coming. You'd spend time with them. They were your friends in Korea, and then they would leave. You know, it's a very transient community. You know, you'd have a friend for 1 year or so, and then you'd have to make completely, you know, new set of friends. And it's just like you're on the conveyor belt of life. And I just stare out the window, and then maybe I'll exit the train. I'd exit the train, I'd look up at a sign, and I'd see 109 on that train, on the train sign. And I'd be like, that's interesting. That's interesting that I've noticed that. I like to think that I was in a state of nirvana. It was a very zen. I was unencumbered with thoughts of need or desire. Things, I had everything taken care of for me. I had my business, or I had my job, and I had you know, my home, and there was very little that I worried about. The people around me certainly had their concerns, but from my position, it was very stable. And so I was in a moment there of just nirvana, just looking around, like very peaceful, unencumbered with doubts and worries, just living my life. And I would just constantly encounter 109 this, 109 that, around the world. And that's how my story came about. So it's just been a matter of comfort, you know, for me. And nah, but it's been a lonely journey. But they have the whole book collection called The Lonely Planet. The Lonely Planet, they are tour guides, tour books, guidebooks. Lonely Planet. So what does that tell you? We're all alone. Lonely.
We're all alone, but we're really not alone, because we're in this together, maybe in separate, like...
Yeah. Yeah, alone, but lonely, but not alone. Lonely, but not alone. Or maybe the vice versa. Alone, but not lonely.
Right.
You're isolated. You're far away from your people, but you know your people exist, and they have a similar experience or a similar attitude, a similar perspective. So you're not lonely. So I don't know. It's interesting.
Okay, so it's this child's very first time riding on the subway. I'm here with her. The subway is coming, or the metro line is coming. Stay back, Randy. You don't want to get hit by this train. It's coming. Now, today is free. That's why we're riding the train.
But then you pay for it?
It's free, but I just paid. What do they call that, a dumbass?
No.
Well, come on, Randy. Let's move over here.
Oh, my.
First time on this bad boy. It's the right.
So what happened, Randy?
We got off the train.
Yeah.
Whatever you're gonna call it. That was quick.
That was very quick. We took two stops from where we started, and now we're here, about to jump on the K line, the new K line, Crenshaw line, baby. Crenshaw. This way.
Crenshaw.
We didn't come down this way. We took the elevator because we had bikes the other day.
But you went with
I was alone, but I was riding my bike.
Oh, sorry, you did. Okay, that's
I met
right.
That dude in line.
Yeah, that's right. And you interviewed him.
Yep.
That's right.
I was in Germany, cousin Monica and cousin Manuel. Cousin Monica and cousin Manuel and I rode the subway, and cousin Monica's friend was a train conductor, subway train conductor.
Oh, okay.
So we were able to ride in the front, in the very front of the train.
I have telling me that.
So I have video of that. I still have the video, so I'm gonna drop it in right here so you can watch me in Germany in the front. So now
like 2018?
Exactly. 2018.
I can take it off.
No, you can't. You better cover your mouth. Cover your hair like we're in Saudi Arabia. Come on, cover up. Cover up your hair. Yep.
I'm trying to remember the time, baby.
Yeah. it'll be great to see how things change over the years. So this will be the first time, what, the first day opening?
So far, this is the first we can go, right?
Because it's the best. Right. Oh, damn, there's our train right there. Mm-hmm. Let's just jump over these tracks, shall we? No. Well, we're gonna miss it, aren't we? Just sitting there. Well, it's not about the last one, it's about this one. We gotta catch this one. Famous last words. I think it's gonna wait for us. We're gone. Bye.
This is the NIE.
Next time, maybe you'll rush. You'll hurry yourself up. Ready? Go.
That was fun going on the throw high.
Yep.
Please stand clear. The doors are closing.
Oh, hell, really? You didn't hear that message?
I thought it was.
Come on. I think that's open right there.
You didn't spill the oh, not a windows.
What's that?
I said you didn't want to spill the beer, but not a windows.
Next weekend. Can't walk through the trains.
That's what you're trying to do?
I mean, just trying to walk down, yeah. Yes, I was trying to walk.
So why do we go all the way up to Santa Monica and then this?
What's that?
We have to go out to Santa Monica and then we like stranded up there like the last train. And
I don't think that's going to happen. What time do you think the last train runs?
I don't know about this public stuff, maybe.
So what we'll
10 o'clock?
No, I doubt that. But we'll ask someone at the next stop what time the train stopped running, and then that will tell us whether or not we should go. That's thinking ahead, right?
Yeah.
Planning, right? My dad always told me. So that's the moon. Right there, it's a beautiful night. That moon is so visible. West Angeles Church is right on over here that I never go to.
Ooh.
We don't Expo look. Crenshaw.
So we had to catch it over there?
Yeah, right there. Where we came from. Where are you going?
I'm about to push the thing so we could walk across.
What street is this?
Crenshaw.
What?
Crenshaw.
Say it like you mean it, like you're from here.
Can I just go driving my car? Can I just go riding my car? I'm just kidding. Crenshaw.
Alright, get up. Not that fast.
Oh, go down and get back up again.
But it's okay. Never done this before in America, where we are in Santa Monica, checking out the night market. It is what it is. 626 night market. Yakitori Yado, that looks good. What else? That looks good. We have to stop over there and get some chicken. What else? All right, those look good. I think I'm gonna order some. As soon as I order them, bam, right here. Right here. That's what's up.
Oh, that's nice.
All right, Randy, take your first bite out of the spicy.
Oh, this is
yakitori yado. Okay, I know it's for me. So let me get mine. I have to film and eat at the same time. Uh-oh. Okay, spicy.
No, I can film it for you.
Hold it. Turn it around that way. Tastes like chicken. Nice. Nicely seasoned. Tastes like chicken. How's the sauce? Gotta get something to drink now.
Okay.
I don't see any onions on my skewer. You got onions all over there. Chicken and onions. You gonna ask? They got balls. Go ahead. Go ahead and ask. Raw chicken.
Power.
It's the most natural, healthiest drink you can find. A nice day out.
You know? It's cool out here, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm from the east side, so I'd never come over here.
All right.
But I came down and I met friends from out of town.
Nice.
And I love Los Angeles, I love sharing Los Angeles, and it's the best.
Also, thank you guys. See, I'm vlogging too tonight. So
you're vlogging too?
I am, yeah. Okay. I got good content. I got a lot of great things. I got those guys over there. They're good dancers.
Dancing, did you see that?
No, only came here.
They might still be going.
Okay,
down to the promenade.
What about
amazing? No joke.
Seriously.
So, YouTube, Instagram, what's your?
So, I have Instagram. Okay. I'm not famous, I'm just a peasant, basically. But I'm trying to, you know, this content.
All right.
But I woke up Dawn Patrol swimming at Venice Beach. And then came north and met awesome people, as one does, all over Southern California and all over the world. And I'm really happy to be here. And that's what we do.
No.
Meet great people like you guys.
He's a uplifter. Like, honestly, he's like, I don't know, explain him. We just met him today and he's just very positive. And
right on.
I'm not positive. Yeah.
Are you Libra? Very positive.
Are you Libra? No.
What's your sign?
Yeah, what's your sign?
What's your birthday?
Okay. I don't know, but I'm not positive, I'm realistic. And I said this earlier, so with regards to realism, is it there are, you don't need to be optimistic. You don't go like, this could be. Realistically, there are good people. There are great people that come together, and it's great. Optimism feels like dreaming to me. Realism, there's goodness.
That makes sense. Yes.
And that's it.
Yes. Wait, I need an example.
I was born in July. I don't know, man. I'm a dancer.
This is a good example. This guy goes, hey, I have a double chin in the picture. I look gross. And this guy right here was like, you know what? Nobody's looking at that. It's all about the background, all about the smiles, about the faces. You guys are having fun. Like, no one cares about your double chin. Like, I look fat, whatever. But it's like, people are looking at, you're having fun. You're at a cool background. Like, this is great. Like,
that's a really good picture.
Yeah. It's like, we're having fun, and that's all that matters. So, we're preaching.
Your sister's cold.
I don't care. I'm cold.
No, she wants your sweater.
Whatever.
She won't take my sweater.
Thank you very much. You
nice
too.
I offered her my sweater. She said no. I was like, well, take your sister's sweater. Can she have your sweater?
No.
I'm just kidding.
I need it too, man.
Bye. Cheers. Bye.
Cheers.
Enjoy the evening.
Bye, guys. Yeah. Bye. Nice to talk to you.
So our adventure ends here on the train, and we saw 10-9 today. It is 10-9, and yes, we did see 10-9. First and foremost, the last train that we rode here to Santa Monica, we're in Santa Monica right now. The last train that we rode here, the number was 1036. All right, or was it 1063?
Oh, okay.
Either way, it was something like that. So 6 + 3 = 9. So I saw 10 and basically 9. So that was my 10-9 moment for the day. It didn't end there, however, because when Randy and I went to the 626 night market, we ordered some food, and then the number we received, the ticket number was 9. Wow, 9, that's pretty cool, right? Okay. And of course, the next person behind us was 10. But just to hear those two numbers together like that, we didn't get number 11, number 17, 15, number 4, 3, 2, or 1. We got 9 and we 10. So that was pretty cool, right? 10 and 9, there it is again. It was a different moment, but it was still the same. All right, now we're on this train. This is the last little tidbit, numerological moment, you know, significant, insignificant thing I'm going to talk about. The train we're riding is 1004.
Connect here with
or train car 1004A. That's not a 10-9 moment, but you know what that is? In Korean, today is Korean Hangul Day, Korean Alphabet Day. And 1004 in the Korean language is Chunsa. And you know what Chunsa means, Randy? I told you before, you know.
Yes.
What does it mean? Randy.
1004. Oh, wait.
You said it before. Ay, Dios mío. Mapsosa.
It's late. I'm trying to remember.
Oh, okay. Randy's trying to remember. Huh?
It was a...
Oh, yeah. It means angel.
Oh, that's right.
1004 means angel in Korean. Chunsa. So that's how we're going to end this day today. So... maybe numbers don't mean anything, or maybe they do mean something. I'm glad I found some meaning in these numbers, so, and I'm glad I'm able to share them with you. Thanks for watching. Say goodnight, Randy.
Goodnight.
All right, y'all, peace.
761 and 233 towel service to the San Fernando Valley.
All right, so we completed our mission. Riding the K-Rail this weekend, the inaugural weekend for the K-Rail.
In celebration of the new Countryman K-Line, next to the leaping paradise on a mile, mental deaths and noise, make that comment.
Randy looks like she already lives in Saudi Arabia. Moon out. Oh man. So Randy, what was your first ride, first train ride in the city of Los Angeles? First metro ride ever in your life? What would you say? How was it?
It was nice. It was cozy. It was just weird. Like, I don't want to say weird, but like living here like all my life and then, you know, using public transportation like out here. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it. It was just, I just never done it out here. I've always done it on the East Coast.
Yeah, we're accustomed to driving cars. California is a car culture state. So you definitely need a car out here, but it's nice. It's a little nice having the metro rail. However, I imagine New York has had its trouble with keeping their metro lines clean, their subway lines clean, but it seems like California is failing already because it doesn't seem very clean at all to me. That's my impression. Randy, it was sparkling clean in your opinion, right?
The new one was the K line.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah, the K line was pretty sparkling clean, of course, because it's only been open for 2 days. So I remember riding the blue line with Auntie Vivian many years ago. So I imagine if I were to ride the blue line and basically compare the blue line to what it was the day that I rode it, you know, on its inaugural trip, like if it's gross today, then that would be a bad indication for the future of the K line and what have you. Yeah, but the Expo line, we took the Expo line and the K line. That Expo line was a little rough indeed. So but you know, we want to just I guess just want to say it was a safe ride, and that's all anyone can really expect, a safe ride to and from one's destination, and that's about it. So we're making our way back to our destination. It was a safe ride, and that's what's up on my birthday. Yep. So, all right, this is Larry Wiggs reporting live from Los Angeles for IC-10-9. Let's take a look at the moon, shall we? Beautiful moon. Hey, there's a bus rolling by. And there's the moon. La Luna. She has to run to get to that bus.